So I think we should start. So I want to thank my co-organizers, David Krakauer and Michael Lachman. And this is the second of what may or may not become a series of flash workshops, Zoom workshops, in this current difficult and interesting time. Our first workshop 2 weeks ago was primarily about the interactions between epidemiology and economics and strategies for both epidemic recovery and economic recovery. This week's workshop has more to do with human behavior and the different levers that we might be able to use or at least understand that govern people's beliefs about epidemics, about what they how they should act, how they should interact, and what incentives different institutions can offer. So we wanted to bring together experts in social science, psychology, social psychology, and economics. So our first speaker is SFI's Professor Mirta Galesic, and I'm just going to take my finger off the spacebar and call up her bio, which I did not memorize. Thanks for tolerating the technical issues. So in addition to being a professor at SFI, Mirta is also external faculty at the Complexity Science Hub in Vienna, Austria, and associate researcher at the Harding Center for Risk Literacy at the Max Planck Institute. And I think without further ado, we should just let her start talking. Just so everyone understands the format, what worked for us well 2 weeks ago was having each of the speakers go through their talk, roughly 15 minutes, and then we'll open it up to a virtual panel discussion involving all of them. So just a reminder to please stay muted until then to avoid background noise. And without further ado, Mirta Galesic.
Thank you very much, Chris. And you pronounced my last name really well, which is awesome. I will be talking briefly about two opportunities for social science in times of this crisis. One is modeling societal resilience, and the other is science communication. When it comes to societal resilience, we are facing cluster shocks. We have spiking unemployment. We have increasing lines for food banks. We have a lowest measure a level of happiness since 12 years since the hedonometer is measuring happiness on Twitter. We have increasing levels of anxiety as measured by our colleagues from the Complexity Science Hub in Vienna. We have now first societal upheavals. People are protesting to let the to get the economy open again. The guns are being sold in large quantities. And now the question is for all of us, you know, how much more can the current system take? And are we going back to some former normal state, or will the society transform in some more or less adaptive way? And I would suggest that a useful concept to think about is the concept of community resilience. It has been studied a lot in more kind of qualitative areas of community psychology and sociology and governance, which is defined as a set of adaptive capacities enabling adaptation after a disturbance. And we can think of it as this adaptive capacities as falling roughly in three groups: economic capital, social capital, and psychological capital. And they will jointly determine whether after a period of dysfunction in a crisis, a society will, you know, remain roughly as it was, or whether it will transform in something else. Economic capital can be measured in different ways. Level of economic production and the risk of economic production is really, well, US is one of the leading countries in the world, but some other measures such as inequality has been rising over time, access to health insurance, ability to pay emergency expenses, the inequality among different racial and ethnic groups, and also unsurprisingly, the inequality in how different groups are affected is really, really strong in the US. Social capital has been defined in terms of bonding, which are ties within social groups, bridging, which are ties between groups, and linking, which are ties between different groups and the central sources of government and power and resources. And here, well, bonding is pretty good in many communities. So within community relationships are often quite good. We know that increasing polarization over years are putting them in a position where bridging the horizontal linkages between different groups is low. And that there are significant differences in how different groups, what different groups perceive to be a legitimate authority in these times of crisis. And finally, there is psychological capital that psychologists talk a lot about, which is trust, which has been always low in the United States, the trust in government, and it has been decreasing over time. At the same time, the knowledge about crisis has been quite good, which certainly owns to a very strong informational infrastructure that we have, where whole societies can be mobilized in matter of days. The recent research by Wendy Brundenbrun and colleagues from USC on a very large national probabilistic sample has shown that people are really adopting and knowing about behaviors that are important in this present time. So that's something positive. But then all of this together can be a framework to organize our thoughts about what might affect where our society is going to go. Is it going to be a positive adaptation or prolonged dysfunction? And what we need, and what SFI is pioneering also for a long time, are precise quantitative parsimonious models of these complex social systems. So of course, people like Doyle Farmer, Rob Axtell, and Josh Epstein and Ross Hammond have been doing these economic and health models for a while. And now the challenge is to complement them, to integrate also social and cognitive processes. Now, while this was a relatively dark description of the current situation, I see an opening for science in the current time. And this is the opportunity to communicate science to large parts of the population that have previously not been exposed to science to this extent. Trust in medical professionals, the CDC, and hopefully by extent the rest of the scientific community remains high, even when the trust in some other authorities is declining. And this is also, the partisan differences are very small, or even reversed in some cases. So this is coupled with increased time that people now have to spend watching news, all kinds of news, including news about science, and increased interest in all things scientific. So this could be an opportunity for science community to start a dialogue about not only epidemiological issues, current health issues, but more broadly about the value of scientific evidence, of what constitutes scientific process, and what is the value of scientific contributions to the society. Another question is how to communicate science to the general public, how to communicate results of our epidemiological models, but also more broadly about all kinds of scientific issues that are important at present time. And we can imagine this process of forming scientific beliefs as an emerging property, if you wish, of a complex system of individual cognitions and social networks in which people live. And of course, discussing them in detail would take much more time than we have. So let me just highlight a few issues. When it comes to individual cognition, one important skill that is necessary to understand most of the communication about epidemiological issues and other issues today is numeracy, the basic ability to understand numbers. And it can be assessed with a series of very simple questions that to all of us are straightforward. For example, imagine that we flip a fair coin 1,000 times, how many times it will come heads? Or which of the following numbers represents the biggest risk of getting a disease? 1 in 100, 1 in 1,000, or 1 in 10? Or if the chance of getting a disease is 20 out of 100, what would that be in percent? And we have conducted national studies on large samples in the United States and Germany, and surprising result is that more than a quarter of populations in both countries actually do not know answers to these questions. And for example, for this last question, what is 20 out of 100 in percent? It's not that people just don't want to bother answering. They try to come up with some answers. So for something that seems plausible, so they would say 2% or 5% or 50 or 80%. So there is some, there is motivation to kind of understand these numbers, but there is not enough knowledge in the general population because of different educational and professional trajectories that we all take. However, all is not lost. Myself and many teams have been studying formats that it can be understandable even with people with low numeracy. And it has been shown in many studies that adequate visual formats, such as icon arrays, for example, simple bar and pie charts, can be very helpful and can diminish these differences in numeracy in the general population. Another important issue is how do we communicate uncertainty in our estimates? A lot has been talked about recently about different aspects of uncertainty in our estimates. And they can be roughly divided in several different layers of uncertainty. Aleatory uncertainty, so uncertainty because of randomness and chance and luck, or epistemic uncertainty, which is basically a reducible lack of knowledge that we have. So if you do enough research, we would know more. Modeling uncertainty, which is related to how well we specify our models, whether we overfit them and so on. And then deep uncertainty, there is irreducible uncertainty, things that we will never know. And this can be studied in many literatures, from cognitive science to medicine, to environmental science, to economics. The question is, should we communicate this to the general public? Is there a danger that maybe the credibility of sources will be reduced if we communicate uncertainty in our estimates? A recent study, however, just published in PNAS, has shown that this might not be the case. So while communicating uncertainty about our estimates does increase people's general perception of uncertainty in the numbers, or around the numbers that we are communicating, which is okay, the trust in the source is basically not changed, or very little, and not changed, especially if the uncertainty is communicated using precise numeric estimates, such as ranges around the point estimates. So the message of this is, go ahead, communicate uncertainty to the general public. While people overall strive to, you know, clear recommendations what to do, they of course understand that, or they can acknowledge that the estimates often bear certain uncertainty. So communicating this openly is not hurtful. Now, another aspect of science communication is how cognition interacts with social networks. And so we all, when considering whether to adopt a new belief, we often take into account what other people around us think. And this can be rational because we need to rely on our friends and people around us for many issues in our daily life. We cooperate with them. We need to be coordinated and so on. And so it is not surprising that sometimes people are reluctant to change their mind, even if they're factually wrong, if that would put them at odds with their social circles. We also use our social networks to infer a lot about social norms. What is acceptable, what is normal, and what they should do. For instance, in a number of studies, we have found that distributions of different characteristics of people's social circles are very similar to people's predictions of how general population looks like. We know that people's estimate of sizes of different groups, of minority groups, depend strongly on the homophily in their social circles. This is particularly relevant when it comes to estimated prevalence of disease. For example, this was a flu study where people were asked to estimate what is the percentage of other people in the population who had flu. And as one could expect, if participants had flu, these are these lighter gray bars, they estimated population, prevalence of flu in the population was also higher. But this is much more pronounced for people whose friends also had flu. So the more people in our social circle had flu, the higher is the estimate of the population who also had flu. And similarly for vaccination, when people are estimating what is the prevalence of people who vaccinate in the population, this is also strongly related to the number of friends, of their friends who are vaccinating. And then by extension, that also influences their own vaccination behavior. So the more people in people's social circle are perceived to vaccinate, the more likely is that people 1 year and even 5 years later, 5 years later will vaccinate themselves, which kind of goes into contrast with the idea that people are maybe calculating rationally whether they should vaccinate depending on how many other people are vaccinated. So maybe not vaccinating everybody else is already. It is more in line with the explanation related to social norms that people are coping what others are doing. We also know that social circles influence voting intentions. The people live in very homophilous social circles, and the social circles influence own voting intentions. So it's not then also surprising or unexpected to think that people's choice of media and whom to trust will also depend on who their social circles trust. We know, for instance, that it's apparently most Republicans trust mostly Fox News and very little other media, whereas Democrats have more diverse set of media they follow. Which brings me then to my last slide, and which are some implications for science communication based on what of the bunch of results that I've shown. The first is social costs of disagreeing with others might matter more than being wrong. And this is especially so for people who live in highly homophilous social circles and who rely on them for many everyday activities and for help, especially in times of trouble. So we should take this into account when people seem reluctant to accept what seems to us an obvious scientific fact. The second thing is that we should go where people are. If people who are skeptical about scientific beliefs predominantly follow a particular media source, if climate skeptics follow Breitbart, then we should find a way to be more present in this on this media, to advertise there, to give interviews, to be more present on discussion boards, because this is the only way that people will ever hear about this scientific information. So we need to be more proactive in going to these people and not disregarding them as lost cases, because especially in times like this, it is important that that we don't have pockets of society that are reluctant to accept scientific views. The third is that it is important to engage trusted communicators. Even if we engage in the platforms where people are skeptical about science, it is important to find communicators that are trusted in these communities. Perhaps people who share scientific beliefs but are also members of these communities, or even better, peer-to-peer communication. So somehow finding ways to format messages so that they're interesting and fun to share with peers. Another recommendation is to try to reduce increasingly homophilous pockets of society by connecting people from different tribes in non-partisan contexts. A recent study on PNS by Centola and others has shown that if people are put into teams of people from different political orientation and asked to discuss climate trends, that they collectively come with very good estimates of climate trends if they don't know each other's partisan orientation. So there is a potential for collective intelligence if we can overcome these partisan differences, and maybe by designing platforms that, that encourage collective action, collective performance, could help to overcome these differences in interpreting scientific facts. Another recommendation is to organize, as our scientists should be organizing teams and consistently rebuff false information. And this recommendation is motivated by our ongoing research on hate speech, which is a little bit different domain, led by Joshua Garland at SFI, and also joined by Kia Zahedi and Laurent Herbert de Fresne and Gabriel Young, and journalists sponsored by SFI Action. We are finding that on Twitter, it really makes a difference if people engage in counter speech against hate speech. So if citizens react and try to engage, rebuff hate speech. But importantly, it only works if people are organized, if those who engage in counter speech come in groups. This both helps them to persist in when faced with opposition. And also we know from old Ash experiments in social psychology that two voices already are much better than one in overcoming the majority opinion. The sixth point is that we should use formats that can be understood by low numeracy participants. So even when something looks very obvious to us, we should be aware of the 30% of population who do not know what 20 out of 100 is. And we should format our communication so that it can be understood. We know from research in medicine that when people don't understand numerical information, they tend to delegate this decision to whoever they perceive is expert, which can be dangerous if expertise is not well perceived, not accurately perceived. So really taking into account these formatting issues is very important. And my final recommendations is that we should strive to frame messages to reduce social and moral dissonance that people feel when considering a novel belief. Of course, people will always think when considering a belief, what others around them think, how does this also conflict or not with other beliefs one might have. And so understanding better different target audiences, their values, and how the message can be framed so that it's acceptable to them is very important. Or alternatively, finding a more general framework such as pure joy in science, citizen participation, games that where people can participate in science in a kind of less conflicting, cognitively conflicting way would be might be a good way to go. So I would like to thank my various collaborators who inspired me, and of course the Santa Fe Institute and various funding sources.
Thank you very much, Mirta. So our next speaker is Eric Maskin. Eric is the Adams University Professor at Harvard. He received the Nobel Prize in Economics in 2007 with Hurwitz and Meyerson for laying the foundations of mechanism design theory. He got his PhD from Harvard and has also been faculty at MIT, Harvard, and the Institute for Advanced Study. So Eric, do you want to set up your screen sharing? Eric, can you hear me? So some temporary technological issues here.
Stage fright.
Eric, are you having trouble setting up your screen and your audio?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. But we cannot see you, nor do we see your screen.
Okay, so the problem is I lost my presentation. Let me try again.
If you want, we could go on to the next speaker and come back to you.
Why didn't you do that in order to save time?
Okay, Mahzarin, are you comfortable starting up?
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Great, let me pull up my presentation and we can start. Hold on, let me just share my screen.
Why don't I quickly introduce you while you do that?
Yes, you can go ahead and do that.
Mahzarin Banaji is Richard Clark Cabot Professor of Social Ethics at Harvard. She got her PhD from Ohio State in 86 and was a National Institute of Health postdoc fellow at University of Washington in Seattle. So thank you very much for joining us.
Okay, let's see. Can you see my slides?
Yes, we can.
Okay, let me open them up. All right. All right. Does everybody see a slide that says why trust science?
Yes.
Okay, great. All right. So in this moment, I've been looking for bright spots, as Mirta said, and I've been reaching on my bookshelf for things that have been sitting there that I think I had been putting off reading, but this moment made them particularly relevant. And one such piece is my colleague Naomi Orks's book called Why Trust Science? And I just throw it out there for you to think about if you might find it interesting. The reason I have been enjoying reading it is because it is a defense of science, but it's not your typical defense of science. It's a defense through the idea that it's the social character of scientific knowledge that makes science trustworthy. And Naomi is not Pollyanna-ish about this. She understands that the process of doing science is obviously imperfect, but and shows us some spectacular failures. But it's a defense of the rigorous vetting process that we all use to arrive at consensus. And she argues that that's what ultimately affords it, this quality of trustworthiness. And as we are all looking around us and finding that many people who don't have the privileges we do of doing science and understanding science and how difficult it is for them to tell the difference between, say, Donald Trump and Dr. Fauci, in that moment, I actually think that Naomi's ideas need to be taken by us and spread out there so that the social character of science and its trustworthiness can be communicated. There is a second book that you will not have read because it hasn't come out yet. So I'll just throw it out. It'll be out in a month. It's by my colleague, Max Bazerman. If you are a decision theorist or decision scientist, you will know most of the data that are covered in Max's book called Better Not Perfect, but it's really a wonderful review of behavioral science research as with combined with a part of philosophy that has now been taken away by a science, psychology primarily, under the rubric of this area called moral cognition. And he puts these together to tell us that many of us like him can sit on a high horse when it comes to our favorite scientific issues. I have been that way myself, so has Max. Max is a moral vegetarian, and if you don't eat plankton, he says, go to hell. But now, in this moment, Max thinks it's really important for us to come to terms with the fact that we ought to strive to be better, not perfect. And in this moment, I think this message is going to resonate because we need to figure out ways of drawing people into our community, even if we see things in a very clear and stark way. So I give you these two little examples as things you might have read and might read. And I'll get on with what David, I think, has asked us to do, and that is to use this moment to say something about what our science can say to people outside of our own little fields. So I'll just begin with a very simple set of examples. COVID-19 has certain features. It is attention grabbing, it is unusual, and it has this diabolical quality to it, that is to say that it puts us in the path of death. And when events have these properties, cognitive psychologists tell us that we are going to be especially vulnerable to a set of biases. And of course, for people like me, there is the trifecta, the three classic, most important of these biases that affect decision making, and that if we are aware of them, we can guard against them. And those are confirmation bias, anchoring bias, and availability. And I'll just put availability in front of you. You all know these data, so perhaps you won't show this bias, but I have good reason to think even you might show this bias. If I say to you, do more people die from being in a car accident or abdominal cancer? Many of you who know the data that more people die in car accidents than in plane crashes are likely to say car accidents here, and you would be wrong. The right answer is abdominal cancer takes more lives. Let's jump to the third one. These days, if I pose to people the question, do more of us die from an opioid death or a car accident death? More people will say opioid when in fact it is car accidents. And in this moment, we need to smile and laugh a little bit. So I'm gonna give you a funny lack of availability bias in this case, and ask you, which is more frequent, a CEO named David or a female CEO? And if I asked you this, most of you would get it right and you would raise your hand for the answer, a CEO named David. And here you see the opposite, even though we're talking about a very large group of people, like half the world, that turns out not to be the right answer, but a fraction of a percent tends to be the right answer because that's the way the world is. All right, so that's the availability bias, and out of it come a whole bunch of things that we are gonna confront in this moment. And I will tell you about just a few of those and see if in the discussion you wanna pick up on them. One of them that is my favorite is this identifiable victim effect. If you don't know what it is, I'll give you just a very quick example to tell you how it might play out. We know that when a single little cute puppy was stranded on a float in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, many countries spent millions of dollars rescuing this little puppy because it was an identifiable victim. We do nothing about the thousands, if not millions, of street dogs who die every day all over the world, and those get nowhere the same attention. This is the identifiable victim effect. But now, what we are gonna have to do is, on the one, I'm gonna tell you up front that I'm not asking that you be socially inept in this moment. If somebody tells you that their mother has COVID, don't say to them, oh yeah, but many more people are gonna die from heart disease. That is not what I'm asking that you do. But I believe that when it comes to decision making, when it comes to policy, that we are going to be the guardians of knowledge that we're going to have to put out there in order to decide how our government should behave and how and what we should write about, both as op-ed pieces or share more widely, because this is still incredibly invisible knowledge, right? And that is that we must compute what death and suffering means around COVID-19. So I'll just give you one example, and I assume this is going to be recorded and out there, so I want to be sure to say I'm doing this from my memory. I haven't checked these data recently, but as I recall, there was a study done by Gerd Grigorenzer in which he showed that after 9/11, people were so concerned about flying that many more people took to the road and began to drive to get to places they would otherwise have taken a plane to. And that caused, I think in his analysis, it was at least 1,800 more deaths above and beyond what would have been expected. Now, think about 9/11 and then think about these deaths. One, extremely visible. It has all these properties of attention-grabbing, unusual, diabolical. And yet that's what will get attention as opposed to these invisible silent deaths. And this is the job of scientists. It is to make sure that these other factors are brought to the front and that our policies and our decision-making are driven by that full range of data and not by the fact that I personally right now stand to be hurt far more by coronavirus, given that I'm over 64 and have several underlying conditions. Okay. All right, so that's one. And in fact, one of the jobs of any field that we're in is to make this the stuff that's invisible visible. And so I'll take a couple of quick other examples. I've been reading this a lot. Everywhere you go, it says the virus doesn't discriminate. And that is true. When the virus is confronted by Boris Johnson, the virus doesn't look at Boris Johnson and say, the prime minister is showing a lapse in ordinary reasoning. The prime minister is an important person, and so I should not infect him. The virus will infect Boris Johnson as it would anybody else. So in that sense, the virus does not discriminate idea is absolutely true. And I think among the things that we're gonna have to raise awareness about is the notion of how, I'm just using gated communities as a metaphor, but that gated communities are not going to work. We are only as safe as the most vulnerable person in the world, not the most vulnerable person in my home or in my neighborhood or in my country, although those do matter, but the most vulnerable person in the world. And that could be somebody in Wuhan who happens to be near a civic cat that got a coronavirus, okay? So this is an idea that I think is very difficult for most people to grasp. And they will talk about building walls and building gated communities. And if this moment has taught us anything, it is that more powerful ideas of learning about how things actually work rather than building walls is going to be something that I hope we can communicate and be successful at doing that. But I want to turn this idea that the virus does not discriminate on its head. And I want to argue that although the virus does not discriminate, the effects of the virus are deeply discriminatory. The virus must pass through individuals and societies that have a particular structure and a particular nature. And in doing so, its effects are not going to be a flat line. I'll just give you a simple fact that should be stunning to us from Chicago. 30% of Chicago is African American. Close to 70% of people infected with coronavirus in Chicago are Black. How are we going to get these ideas out while also understanding the notion that the virus does not discriminate is complex, and I'm hoping that the social sciences will be able to use this moment to be able to hold these two seemingly contradictory ideas together and showing both sides of them. In my own work, most recently, although I was trained in a way that required me to read the founding figures of the social sciences, like Du Bois and Marx and Weber, and especially Durkheim, who was the most psychological of them, I had set these thinkers completely aside, thinking I am doing modern work using, you know, computational linguistic analyses, and what do they have to say to me about that? I didn't say that, but I assume I was thinking that because I rarely relied on them. And I just want to say how important it has been for me to go back to these ideas and to see the deep connection between these original writings from about a century ago and what work we're doing today that is experimental and that is computational. And in particular, I've been relying on the idea of Emil Durkheim, the notion of collective representations, this notion that apparently doesn't translate very well from the French into the English and translates almost as if it's a collective consciousness, but I want to be very clear that you do not confuse this with a Jungian or psychoanalytic notion of a collective consciousness. So don't take that as true. There's some strange idea that if I'm Jewish, I will be able to learn Yiddish a little bit faster than somebody who's not Jewish. That's not the collective consciousness that I'm talking about. I am talking about social facts, hard things that are embedded in our society and that you cannot figure out by looking at individual minds, that these are emergent phenomena and an idea, an SFI idea, if we ever saw one, that these are going to have to be found in the minds of individuals and the right attribution to be made to their existence in this larger structure. And so Durkheim asks the question, how are these social facts spread from one individual to another, and how do they become a part of this, these collective representations? And he says, language. Yes, there are lots of pictures and images and so on, but the primary and the most prominent, easy, invisible way in which we communicate all of these social facts that become reality, whether true or not, is through language. And so I want to tell you that you will have the occasion to participate in a seminar that Jennifer Dunn very generously supported. We were supposed to be at SFI on the 23rd and 4th of April to have a small group meeting on this topic, on the topic of language as a window into human minds, bringing together people like Mirta, a bunch of computer scientists, and some psychologists to talk about different levels of analysis that we are all using, but to look at this question of how much of what we know can be found embedded in our language. And I think we can use this notion right now to show people the ways in which bias in AI, bias in the way in which our language unfolds, are ways in which we can capture who we actually are rather than what we think we are. And my own work, which uses a technique called word embeddings and which looks at large corpora of language, goes in there to look at the company a word is keeping. The company a word keeps, that is to say what word it sits next to, is a very powerful way of capturing the semantic connections between ideas. And this has taught us a great deal about the connections that we see as we study them in our minds using IAT data from the web, where millions of people have visited and given us good indications of what the mental representations are. And then Eileen Kaliskin, this wonderful computer scientist, went off and analyzed, I don't know, 8 billion words from Google, and shows that what we discover to be true in our minds is also visible in our daily language. And so some of these ideas have come together. And I think this is a moment for scientists sitting around trying to understand the world to do a little reflection on integrating what we do across disciplines, but also a little bit across history. And for me, the linkages to what I'm doing with this computational work and the works of people like Durkheim have been startling to me. I'm going to end because I think my time is up. I don't know, I could keep going, but I think my time is up. And I'm just going to say that I wake up every morning and I read Andy Borowitz, because without Andy Borowitz, life is just unbearable. And I'll give you the one from yesterday so that you can smile a little. And Andy's comment was, no one could have seen this pandemic coming except people capable of reading. And with that, let me say thank you for inviting me. It is just wonderful to be part of this community. And thank you to the 70 of you who are here.
Thank you very much, Mahzarin. Actually, there are 96 at the moment, so.
All 96, so, thank you.
Eric, are you set up again?
Yes, I am. And this time I can find my presentation.
Okay.
You see it?
Yes, we do. Thank you very much. Our next speaker will be Eric Maskin.
Okay, so we're used to thinking.
And we see Eric?
I turned my video off because I find it distracting to look at myself.
I find it distracting to look at you too, Eric.
I don't blame you. Most of the time, we get goods and services through markets, and that's how producers of these goods also interact through markets. But in an emergency, and a pandemic is certainly an emergency, it may be necessary to go beyond markets. For example, the governments may want to very quickly acquire hundreds of thousands of ventilators or generate millions of virus and antibody tests or acquire personal protective equipment. And the big question associated with these goals is how can producers be given the right incentives to produce these items and produce the right quantities of these items outside of markets? In fact, how do we even know what the right quantities are? Well, that's something that mechanism design was developed to try to answer. So let me start with markets because they're more familiar. In a normal world, the market itself will do a good job of allocating goods and resources and to see that they're produced in proper quantities. And the economists here are familiar with the logic. Let me go through it quickly. Let's imagine that there are many buyers and sellers, consumers and producers, and let's suppose that each consumer gets some benefits, which I'll call BI of XI, from consuming XI. Similarly, to produce a quantity YJ, a producer must incur some cost for that production. So we can write the total net social benefit from this good as the sum of the benefits to the consumers minus the sum of the costs to the producers. And we're presumably interested, if we were a social planner, in maximizing that expression, subject to supply equaling demand. Now notice that this is actually a fairly complicated maximization. Not only do we have to get the total quantities right, the total supply and the total demand, but we also want to get each individual producer's production correct and each individual consumer's consumption correct. And remarkably, the markets solves this maximization problem, and it does so through the device of a price, a market price, which a consumer has to pay and a producer receives. So that means that each consumer will be maximizing her benefit from consuming XI minus the amount she has to pay for that consumption, And that means that we use a little bit of calculus. The first order condition for this maximization will be the derivative of the benefit set equal to the price. And similarly, each producer will maximize its profit, its revenue from producing YJ minus the cost of that production. And similarly, there will be a first order condition for that maximization. Well, it turns out that those two maximizations are just the first order conditions for maximizing total net social welfare. This is social welfare subject to the supply equals demand constraint. First of all, the price adjusts to make sure that supply equals demand. And then we get, when we maximize the expression at the top, we get the same first order conditions that we saw for consumers and producers. So that's the story for a world with markets. We solve this optimization problem. What if there is no markets? For example, suppose that the government needs a lot of ventilators very quickly, so many that the ordinary ventilator producers cannot possibly produce them. The government might try to get other firms into the act, car manufacturers like GM, to produce them. Question is, even supposing you can get these other firms to produce, how much should they produce? The government could order GM to produce 100,000 ventilators, but that might be a terrible number from an efficiency standpoint, because the government doesn't know how much it's going to cost General Motors to produce these ventilators. There may be other companies that can produce 100,000 much more cheaply. Another thing the government could do is to set a price that it will pay for ventilators and let all potential producers of ventilators get into the act, but that runs into the problem that the price, how does the government know what price to set? Doesn't know what the cost functions are, so it doesn't know how much companies are going to produce at a given price, the price might be set too high or too low given the government's lack of information. So that's where mechanism design comes in. And it turns out that we can use a variation on the Vickrey-Clark-Groves mechanism, which I will explain to you, to solve the government's problem. So let's think of the government's benefit from ventilator production as some function B of total production. So YJ is how much a particular company produces, how many ventilators they produce. The total production is just the sum of those YJs. Now the government wants to maximize net social welfare, which will be its gross benefit from production minus the various producers' costs. Now, the government doesn't know those various producers' costs, so what can it do? What it can do is to have the firms report those costs. Now, of course, they may not necessarily report them truthfully, but it turns out that there is a way of getting them to report their costs accurately. And let's suppose for the moment that they are reporting accurately. What the government can do now that it knows what the costs are is to what quantities it should have each producer produce. What YJ solves net social welfare. Solves the maximization of net social welfare. And then it can tell each firm K how much to produce. Now it turns out that what the government should pay affirm is this expression here. What is this expression? Well, these two terms over on the left are net social welfare, leaving firm K out of the picture. So this is the benefit from production, and this is the sum of the costs where we're not including firm K as one of the producers. Over here in the square brackets, we're imagining that the government performed this maximization without firm K being in the picture at all. So this is where firm K is in the picture. This is where firm K is not in the picture. The difference between these two expressions is firm K's marginal impact on the rest of society. That's what it should be paid. And let me show you now that if it is paid this amount, it will in fact report its cost function accurately. So this is the expression that I was just talking about. This expression in square brackets doesn't depend on firm K at all. Firm K is left out. So we can just concentrate on the first two terms. And we can notice that firm K's own maximization problem will be this expression here, the amount it's paid, minus the amount it has to, the amount of cost it has to incur in order to produce YK. So this expression here is firm K's objective function. The benefit it receives, the transfer it receives, minus its cost of production. But this expression is just the welfare function for society. And we already said that that this expression will be maximized when each firm's production level, YJ, is equal to YJ star. So by reporting its true cost function, firm K will ensure that the correct output, YK, is chosen in order to maximize net social benefits. This is actually a standard idea in mechanism design, that in order to get the incentives of producers, consumers, whoever is involved, lined up with what is good for society, what you should do is to give each individual an objective function, which is essentially the social objective function. That is, you give them a transfer that makes their maximization look exactly like the social maximization. Well, that's how to solve the ventilator problem. The same idea can be used for many other emergency economic issues. Of course, in reality, we're never going to use a mechanism which is this involved. We're not going to have a firm report its entire cost function. At best, we're going to have a firm report a few parameters of that cost function. Nevertheless, the idea can be used. It has been used for many other purposes in the past, and with a government that is interested in social welfare, it can be used in an emergency like the current one as well. Let me stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eric. So just a time check, it's 1:57 here. If the remaining two speakers take 15 minutes each, we'll have half an hour left for a panel discussion and discussion between the speakers if they wish afterward. So Matt, are you all set up? May I introduce you?
Yes, I'm ready to go.
Great. So our next speaker is Matt Jackson. He was educated at Princeton and Stanford and is now the William D. Eberle Professor of Economics at Stanford. He's also an external faculty member at the Santa Fe Institute, something which I neglected to say about the previous two speakers, and also a senior fellow of CIFAR in Canada. So thank you very much for joining us.
Great. Thanks. Thanks a lot, Chris. And it's a pleasure to be part of this group. And everyone see my screen? Is that showing up? So somehow.
Yes. Yes.
Wonderful. Okay. So I want to talk a little bit about coordination, and I want to talk about in terms of the what we're discussing here, the understanding of networks of human biases, networks of human exchange, and dynamics of markets. I want to put some of those together and talk a little bit about why it's important to have coordination. And let me just start by putting up the list of all the human diseases that have been eradicated in history. And as you can see, that's a pretty short list. So the WHO declared smallpox as eradicated, but that's the full extent of the list. And I think, you know, trying to understand how humans need to be corralled in settings like a pandemic, first, we have to understand some of the externalities that are present and the need for a government. And I think that, you know, when we think about situations here, it's pretty clear that any given individual doesn't necessarily fully account for the impact that their particular disease or catching of that disease might have on others. So, you know, the basic externality here starts with that and then goes into something that Mirta alluded to, which is that, you know, there's a lack of numeracy. So people don't understand exponential growth and the fact that not only does their particular catching of a disease influence a few people around them, but it actually can influence many farther down a chain. So we have two basic biases that are problematic. Then we have all kinds of other human biases in terms of cognition that go on top of that. We react to observed dangers. This is one that's hard to observe until it's really taking off. We have amnesia. We forget lessons from our past. We have a herd mentality in the sense that we can have a false security if others not acting around us. And when you couple that with social media and the fact that many people live in fairly isolated social bubbles, that means that people can be completely ignorant of the broader implications of what's going on and feel relatively safe if nobody around them seems to be taking this seriously. And so we need to deal with that problem. And this disease can be partly or even wholly asymptomatic for some time periods. And so when you put all these together, it's clear that individuals on their own are not necessarily going to be taking the right kinds of actions. I think one thing that's we're seeing is that not only do individuals not necessarily take this as seriously as they should, but also governments themselves don't necessarily take it as seriously as they should, and nor do they coordinate with each other. And one thing I want to spend a little time on, I think this is very important, is that we need more coordination between governments. And this is true within regions in the United States, within across countries in the world. And it's pretty clear that this disease is going to recur. And I think we want to avoid a sort of whack-a-mole kind of approach to dealing with the disease. And I think one graph is quite useful. This is from a paper from 2006 looking at the 1918, what's often known as the Spanish flu, the first H1N1 large pandemic. And one thing that you can see here is that there's a first peak. In this case, this is deaths in the UK. There's a first peak at the end of the summer. So this was partly happening around the demobilization of the First World War. And then things looked reasonably good for a while. then you saw the second peak, the shadow was actually much larger than the first peak. And then you actually had a third peak, and it didn't end for more than a year after that. So you had a very long protracted bout with this disease. And you know, part of the issue is that you don't completely stamp this out. And so where you're closing one place down, I think of it as, you know, exterminating termites in a house. So if you spot you have termites in your bedroom, you don't just close down the bedroom and try and get rid of the termites there. You fumigate the whole house. And the way the world has been reacting has essentially been, you know, hitting room by room. And essentially, we'll just keep dealing with resurgences once a group tries to open up. And in terms of, you know, this means that this disease will recur, and we need more coordination to make sure that we're following a worldwide policy and not just a country by country policy. And I think, you know, Mahzarin sort of talked a little bit about gated communities and the fact that we're not just going to close this disease out in one place. And when it's growing rapidly now in Africa and other parts of the developing world, if we don't deal with that, we're going to just continue to deal with resurgences of this disease over time. Second thing I want to deal with is this notion of networks of exchange and so forth. And I think, you know, from Santa Fe Institute's perspective, one thing that's fascinating here, and we don't have a lot of science for so far, is that we essentially have three different interacting complex systems at the same time, three different networks. So we have the pandemic, which is operating in human contact networks. Then we have businesses that are being shut down and or closed down for short periods of time. And they are interacting through some kind of supply chain, both within a country and across countries. And then we have financial networks where money is flowing back and forth, which are eventually going to be seeing defaults from this pandemic. And all three of these systems are interacting at different levels and in different types of networks. And so I want to spend a little time just, you know, sort of highlighting some of the supply chain issues, because I think that they're going to become very large in trying to figure out how to reopen things. And it's worth taking a look at that. So in terms of supply chains, now when we look at production of some good, often parts are sourced from other parts of the economy and from other firms. And you know, you can't produce medical supplies, for instance, without key parts that wouldn't look essential if you just looked at that. So there's plastic manufacturers that are making packaging, which is going to turn out to be important for producing medical supplies. And you can't produce the medical supplies unless you have the packaging. So you should be thinking about this holistically. And to give you some idea of the magnitude of this issue, let me just sort of, you know, start with an example that actually comes out of the 2011 earthquake and tsunami that hit Japan. And at that point in time, there were a number of plants that were hit in that area. And in particular, there was a plant of a company called Renesas Electronics. It was a plant in Naka, which actually produces 20% of the world's MCUs. And what are MCUs? These are microcontroller units that are used in cars. So if you look at a typical car will have something like 50 of these different units. They're this little microprocessing units that are, you know, integrated circuit boards that are put into different things to control your fuel injection or your radio or your air system or anti-lock brakes. So there's many of these in the car. And so when you looked at the companies that were sourcing this, this is the list of the percentage of cars, the production drop that occurred compared to previous years. And here you've got Toyota, Nissan, Mazda, Honda, and then the total in Japan. And originally Toyota thought it would be back online very quickly because it didn't really have that many parts that were directly sourced from this. It didn't realize that indirectly, most of its parts were all sourcing these MCUs from there. So it took them nearly 6 months to get back online where they were producing at a normal level, even though their plants weren't directly impacted. Same thing with Nissan, Mazda, Honda, and you look at the total production drop just from this particular MCU unit. There's a very critical piece in a long chain that held up the whole production process. And so when we start thinking about opening an economy or thinking about which businesses are essential or non-essential, we can't lose sight of the fact that these are all intertwined now. And just a couple of pictures, this is what the world supply chains look like. Each dot here is an industry, and they're connected if they're sourced more than a certain percentage, a small percentage of their production from another industry. This is what it looked like in 1995. And this is a picture in 2011. And you can see that it's a much denser network. And in particular, for instance, goods go back and forth across the ocean between the US and China very frequently. Japan's involved. There's a number of countries that have vital production of parts that are used in other pieces of production. And not accounting for that means that we'll really have problems in terms of opening our economy if we're not opening it in a holistic manner. So reopening, we have to figure out not, what's essential is not just providing safety and health, but also dealing with things that we have these interacting systems where we have disease dangers of reopening things. We also have to be thinking carefully about these supply chains. And then we also have to be thinking about the fact that all of these feed into a financial system, which is both giving the loans out to these places and at danger from defaults from different businesses and consumers. So I think, thinking about policies in this kind of world where we have these interacting complex networks, we can start with just the basics that deal with the human behavior. And so one is gets back to things that Mirta was talking about, basic information. And here I put education, so trying to communicate to people and help them understand the situation. I also put propaganda. And normally we think of propaganda as a bad thing, but this is a situation where I think you need to reinforce to people the importance of their particular individual behaviors for the broader system and have that be a consistent and powerful message. Obviously we need extensive and strategic testing, which has been a big hole in policy. Then we need to deal with incentives. So how do we deal with incentives to make sure individuals are actually acting the way we'd like them to and firms are? Eric just talked quite a bit about mechanism design in terms of helping firms deal with this crisis and help us out in dealing with this crisis. There's also an interesting question at this point in time. I think there was a fascinating article in Science just a couple of days ago about tracing apps. So now we have the ability to be tracking people with close proximity and being able to tell who's interacting with whom. And so we could actually send you a text message saying, look, we're just within 6 feet of somebody who has COVID. You should be aware of that. And that would be something that's fairly easy to do. Of course, you could take this much further and actually track people around and try and control their movements. And that's why I put a question mark here. There's a lot of privacy issues here, but we have technological abilities to actually take care of what individuals are doing and try to better manage the system in terms of the pandemic. Then we have also this third part, this coordination that's necessary in dealing with these three particular interacting systems. And I think, one way in a sort of a really basic way to think of this is what the things that are vital to open are ones that have low disease risk, high business importance, and high financial centrality in terms of their potential to cause issues in contagion inside the financial network. And moreover, when we think about opening things, it doesn't make sense to be opening things in China where they're producing parts that are being used in plants that are idle in the US and then have it flip around where we're opening these systems and not able to source parts from other parts of the world. So we should be thinking about whole supply chains. And that means not only national coordination, but international coordination on reopenings. The last thing I wanted to talk about is just, I think, ultimately we're going to be dealing with this for a long time, and we are going to need a government aid package that's going to deal with the sort of three facets of this. And so I was calling that the New Deal. And effectively, one thing that we're already seeing is displaced workers. We're probably going to hit things that go well beyond the Great Depression very soon. We're already at well over 15 million unemployed, and the peak of the Great Depression was about 24.9 million unemployed. So we'll probably blow through that by this summer. And so, you know, we need to be dealing with the fact that demand is going to evaporate in the economy. And we want to make sure that we avoid panic and hoarding and a spending freeze, which was one of the big problems in the Great Depression until the New Deal really got moving. On the supply side, we need to make sure that people are getting, companies are getting the support that they need. And they need to be getting that in ways that don't cripple them. So if your business is shut down and you're getting no revenue, adding debt to that to try and cover that, the lost costs that you're paying, that's not going to work very well. So we need very careful thoughts about ways of giving equity and forgivable loans. And this should be done with this mind of these are supply chains and there's certain businesses that are much more critical than others. And then again, we need to bring in the financial networks and anticipate that we're going to have large scale business, consumer and country defaults. And you know, figuring out exactly how to do this. This is something I've been spending a lot of time on in the past few years, looking at financial networks and trying to figure out how to get capital in to help in situations. And here we can actually anticipate. I think you can see this coming in the coming year. So we actually have an advantage in that time. I've, you know, talking to people in Italy, they're thinking about some of these problems of how we do this in this sort of coordinated policies, these, you know, thinking about these interacting systems. I'm not aware of that going on in the US government, but I think that, you know, we need this kind of coordination happening between governments and thinking very carefully about the fact that these are three very closely interacting systems, and we shouldn't be thinking about just reacting to one and not thinking of the others. So that should be a good place to stop and turn it over to John.
Thank you very much. Okay, our last speaker is John Geanakoplos, who was educated in mathematics and economics at Yale and has been, he is now the James Tobin Professor of Economics there and the director of the Cowles Foundation for Research and Economics. I won't mention his many prizes and fellowships, just to say that he's been involved in SFI's economic efforts for many years. So John, take it away.
Thank you, Chris. Can you see my screen? Have I done this right?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so I'm going to try and the crisis is moving from a health crisis into an economic crisis. And I want to draw an analogy between the 2008 and 2020 crises and use this as an excuse to explain a little bit about the leverage cycle and how I think that's what's going to happen this time too, the same kind of crisis. So in the 2008 crisis, people tried to explain it after the fact as a greed and dishonesty caused by greed and dishonesty or a panic, especially the people who ran the economy then described it, Bernanke and Geithner, as a panic that they managed to quell. I thought of it as a leverage cycle, a building up of too much debt and too much leverage, at which point a little bit of bad news could cause a crash without any panic. And that reason why it took us so long to get out of the crisis was because we didn't forgive debt, and the Fed, although it acted very boldly, didn't act nearly boldly enough. And so part of my talk is going to be about what the Fed is already doing now. The Fed has already acted before the economic crisis has hit its full-fledged, it's going to get much worse. The Fed is already acting more boldly now than it did in 2008. So that's where I'm going to end up. So I thought of the whole idea of the leverage cycle before the crisis, because I had some experience on Wall Street and I helped to run a firm that had problems that are similar to what happened in the 2008 crisis and the current crisis. And that same firm, Ellington Capital, still exists now. So all the programs meant to help businesses and so on are things that could affect my business. And so I'm thinking about them all the time. We haven't taken any of that relief. We've refused it, but I'm well aware of what the government's going on because, you know, my firm's in jeopardy too. So
The standard theory of economic crises, the old theory, was that the booms and busts came because demand soared and then plummeted. Animal spirits, that was Keynes' idea. And the central bank was set up so that in times of bust, it would lower the interest rate to stimulate investment. And then when things were overheated and inflation was taking off, it would raise the interest rate. So the Fed in the 2008 crisis and now, it did lower the interest rate both times, but that's not nearly the most important thing it did in either of these cases. And it's to tell you about the other things it's doing that's the subject of my talk. So by the way, the crises in 2008, that crisis began with delinquencies in subprime mortgages. It began in subprime mortgages when people realized that some borrowers weren't paying back their mortgages. The crisis, so that wasn't a demand shock. The current crisis began with a supply shock. People can't go to work. Now, of course, that eventually will become, as Matt said, a demand problem, but it began as a supply shock. And the real crisis is going to emerge in 2020 as it did in 2008 when the credit markets collapsed. So what do we mean by tight credit? That even requires some explanation. In the old theory, that would just mean the interest rate's too high, and so what we could do about it is just lowering the interest rate, which the Fed already did. But that doesn't really fix very much, because tight credit doesn't mean the interest rate's too high. It means that at the going interest rate, it's very difficult to get a loan. So it's very difficult to get a loan now if it's not from the government. You may have noticed yesterday that J.P. Morgan, one of the biggest mortgage lenders, announced they weren't giving more than 80% LTV loans. You have to put 20% down now all of a sudden. So it's lending is going to get much more difficult. Borrowing is going to get much more difficult. So the first ingredient of what I want to talk about is collateral. What you put up to guarantee a loan, like your business or your house. And of course, the measure of the safety of it is the ratio of the collateral to the amount of the loan, and that's what's called leverage. So I never heard anybody mention collateral when I was a graduate student in the early 80s, late 70s, early 80s. In the 86, Bernanke, who was the head of the Fed during the 2008 crisis, he started writing about collateral, and then there were a series of papers in 97 about collateral, and that's going to be my subject. My approach was different because I was worried about the change in leverage, the change in that ratio, and that's what I'm going to talk about. So just to remind you, leverage, when you buy a house that's worth $100 and you put $20 down, the margin is $20. The loan to value, you've borrowed $80 on the $100 house, that's 80%, and the leverage is 5 because only $20 of cash got you a $100 house, multiplied your purchasing power by 5. Of course, they're all the same way, different ways of saying the same thing. Now, the reason why leverage has always been regarded as important is because it's connected to risk. If the house goes down to 99, then you sell it, you've got to pay back the 80 still, so you end up with $19 out of your original 20. You lost 5% of your original money, even though the asset only went down 1%. So leverage also shows the magnification in your position. So that's the first ingredient. You're going to see how these fit together. The second ingredient is uncertainty. We're in an incredibly uncertain moment now. Who knows how long the coronavirus problem is going to last? Could be 2 months. It could be 2 years. We just don't know. And that causes a tremendous amount of uncertainty. How do we measure the uncertainty? Well, one measure of it is how much the stock market seems to go up or down every day as news changes. And you see that in 2008, it hit a spectacular high, 80% volatility. And now we've passed that high. It's actually come down to 45%. But anyway, a few weeks ago, we passed the 2008 level of uncertainty just measured by the stock market up and down. So, connection is that when the world seems safe and there's little volatility, that's the time when leverage is high. You can get a 95% LTV loan. And the third ingredient is going to be that means the prices of things go up. So when you have high uncertainty like now, It's very hard to get a loan with much LTV. It's very hard for businesses to borrow anything if the government doesn't lend to them. And so new businesses, which maybe the government's not going to lend on, they're going to have a lot of hard time doing anything. And therefore, the value of the things that they want to buy are going to go down. Activity is going to go down. And so I'm suggesting that this credit part of the story, which was Jackson's third element, is actually going to turn out to be more and more important as time goes on. So what's the policy implication? The policy implication is the Fed should have constrained leverage in the boom times before the 2008 crisis. They should have constrained it before today. So they I'm going to show you that they let leverage get very high. That's why some of these corporate companies are in so much trouble now. And then once there's a great deal of uncertainty, the government has to step in. Nobody's going to step in to do the lending if the government doesn't do it. It has to boost leverage. So it's leverage, not the riskless interest rate, that's the key variable. Okay, so people had mentioned leverage before. Minsky and Kindleberger are two famous economists who'd mentioned it, but they had no mathematics. They didn't even mention the word collateral. So their definition of leverage was the ratio of a corporation's debt to its income. And it was all about irrational behavior. You know, even if people are thinking, because they're genuinely worried about the coronavirus, they don't have to be crazy to know that the world's uncertain. So if you think a little bit mathematically, you get to a puzzle. And the first puzzle is, how can one supply equals demand equation for a loan determine the interest rate, which it's usually supposed to determine, but also the amount of collateral, the amount of leverage? How does it determine that you pay 6% for a mortgage and also you can buy 90%, you can borrow 90% of the house or 95% of the house? That's two variables and only one equation. So that requires a little mathematics to think about. And the solution is that it's not just one market, it's many markets. So for every piece of collateral, there are many possible different promises you could make. And each of those is a different market. So if you think of the loan to value, the bigger, same piece of collateral, same house, you make bigger and bigger promises. If the promises are small, the loan to value is going to be very small, and the lender is going to feel very safe. So the interest rate on the vertical axis is going to be the riskless rate, 1 plus R. After you pass a point, it's going to start to seem risky. And that, as it starts to seem risky, if you want to get a bigger and bigger loan, you're going to be charged a higher and higher interest rate. So thinking mathematically, you're forced to come up with the credit surface, that there's not just one collateral rate. There are many different, so it's a whole surface. So borrowing and lending shouldn't be described by an interest rate, which is what the newspapers always talk about. They should be talking about a whole surface, the credit surface. I'm going to come to real credit surfaces very soon. The conceptual credit surface starts low interest rate, then it gets higher. So what do we mean by tight credit? It's not a high or low interest rate. Tight credit means a steeper credit surface. So the red credit surface is tight. It's when you know, very soon you have to start paying a high interest rate. With the loose blue credit surface, you can borrow a lot more on your house before the interest rate starts to go up. So it's the steepness of the credit surface. If you try and look, I don't know if this shows up, but if you look from here to here, that's very steep, whereas from here to here is quite flat. So the flatness or steepness of the credit surface matters. Now, if you had only two things that could happen in the world, you can prove, as Anna Fostel, one of my students, who's now a professor at Virginia, and I proved that people will always, with only two possible outcomes, a bad one and a good one, everybody will always lend, the credit surface will be steep enough, so everyone always chooses the point A. So in the steep credit surface, the red one, they'll choose A without much loan to value. And the loose credit surface, they'll take a big loan to value. And you notice where A is depends on the worst possible state, because you feel at risk when the promise exceeds the worst value of the house that can happen tomorrow. So if the worst value of the house is not, if the down risk is small, you're going to be able to borrow all the way up to the blue A instead of the red A. So down risk or in the symmetric case, down risk is symmetric to up risk, so it means volatility. So down risk or volatility is determining leverage, how much you can borrow with the collateral you have. So here I've connected volatility with leverage. And now leverage, and so the market sort of has understood this for a while. If you look at any trading markets, you know, the commodities market, you see there's a connection between the margin and how much volatility there is. Higher volatility, higher margins. Okay, leverage also determines asset prices. That's a key idea. If people can only put 2% down on their house, a lot of people will try to buy houses. The price of housing is going to go up. If they have to put 20% down, as they're about to have to do starting now, the price of houses is going to go down, and the prices of a lot of other things is going to go down. The prices of businesses are going to go down. Okay, so to put it all together, there's the low volatility, safe world means a flat credit surface, high leverage, and a booming economy. Uncertainty, the bottom thing, creates a steep credit surface. People don't borrow very much, low leverage, and the activity and prices get very low. And the Fed has to intervene by doing something in the credit surfaces. And so that's what the Fed's doing now, as I'm going to come to in a second. That's how the Fed has to act. And by the way, the crash is much bigger if there's a, it's not just volatility is high, uncertainty is high, and so you have a slow economy. If it starts at a point where uncertainty was low and everything's very leveraged, and then suddenly uncertainty gets high, which is what happened, this came out of nowhere, this coronavirus crisis. So everybody was very leveraged, and now suddenly uncertainty is high. That's when you get a terrible, terrible things happening in the economy. And the basic idea, which I'm going to skip, I guess, is that I'm going to skip it anyway, why it's so fragile. So I don't have time to describe that. So let me just get to the punchline here. So you can see in the last crisis that leverage and this was mortgage securities prices. The blue one is LTV, how much leverage you have. The red one is prices, and the prices went up and down together with leverage. And then if you look at housing prices, they also went up and down together in the last crisis. And so now what's happening today? So today, I've gotten the Washington Fed in the last few years has gotten interested in this and is producing credit surfaces. So here's a credit surface for the mortgage market. So if you look at the loan to value on the one axis, you see at the southwest corner, 50s, very low, very safe loan. You're only borrowing half the value of the house. FICO is your credit score, so 820 means very safe, good borrower, high credit score. So here are the safest loans. Over here is low FICO, okay, bad credit score, and also very high leverage, 95% leverage. So the interest rate is higher. This is the vertical axis, the interest rate. These are all loans made by the government during the sixth month of 2006. So this is an actual, you know, close fit that the Fed produced of what the credit surface was in 2006. Very flat credit surface. Well, look what happened in 2008 as the crisis began. Much steeper, much tougher to make a loan. Curiously, in 2016, it hadn't gone down that much for low FICO people. So low FICO people have never been allowed to borrow after the last crisis. Hard to get a mortgage if you're a low FICO person. Okay, now what about the corporate credit surface? Just before the crisis in 2007, it was completely flat. In 2008, the scale also changed. It got incredibly steep, very hard to get a loan. And then in 2017, after the crisis, it got incredibly flat again. So it's been incredibly easy for corporations to get loans, and they've gotten a tremendous number of loans. Okay, so the same thing happened, and I won't go through borrowing. So what we see now is that the credit surface is very steep again. And what the government has to do, the Fed has to do, is it has to go into the parts of the credit surface, just to take one, it has to go into the parts of the credit surface and say, these are the people, not the riskless rate, which it's the old macroeconomics said, just lower the riskless interest rate. It has to go into the risky part of the credit surface and lend to actual businesses and lend on bad collateral, lend to corporations. It's never done this before. This is the first time the Fed is buying corporate debt, lending to businesses, doing all sorts of things. And the reason is the private sector is incapable of lending at reasonable interest rates when uncertainty is so high. It would be crazy. But the Fed knows that if it lends and lends to the whole economy, it can stabilize things. So it's safer to the Fed than it is to the investor. And the upshot is going to be that a lot of businesses are going to lose a lot of value. And the debts they've accumulated in the past are going to be worth more than the values of their businesses. And they'll tend to go under. So like last time, the way that we may be forced, if this thing doesn't end very quickly, we may be forced to forgive, as Matt said, not just the loans that are going to be made by the government to cover the 2 months of closure, but some of the old loans, which will turn out to be unpayable if business activity declines too far and the business's values get to be too low. So for not forgiving debt is one of the main reasons why the last crisis lasted so long. And only the active Fed is going to be crucial to us getting out of this crisis in a couple years and not in 5 years. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much to all the speakers. So we have about half an hour left for discussion. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but on Zoom, there is a thing at the bottom called participants next to chat. If you click there, then there is at the bottom the ability under more to raise your hand. Is that under more? Sorry, I'm the host, so I can't raise my hand, but all of you can raise your hands. So if anyone does that, I will attempt to moderate. And in the meantime, if any of the speakers have questions for each other that they'd like to raise, then go right ahead. Mahzarin, do you need? Sure.
So my question is for John and Michael. Both of you in your talk talked about sort of the right way to do things from, and if there are not big variations amongst economists about what those are, to what extent is our government doing those right now? And I ask that because in 2008, we could have said that we had amnesia because the Great Depression had been so long ago, but this is kind of on the heels of the past one. So has there been a certain level of learning? Did the infusion come a little more quickly? Are we seeing some evidence that we learned is the question.
I can start because I think I have an easier answer than Matt talked about a broader array of issues. Some of his issues involve things that had no antecedent in 2008. The part that I talked about, which was the credit crunch that occurred in 2008 and which has already begun now and is going to get much worse very soon. The Fed definitely did learn. So the Fed already weeks ago in 2008, Bernanke went far beyond what any Fed had done before. And now at the very beginning of this crisis, the Fed's gone far beyond what Bernanke did. So I think the Fed has learned its lesson and is doing a tremendous amount. And the $2 trillion stimulus, you might remember that in 2008, Obama was trying to pass a stimulus package. And he had, you know, he convinced himself that it would be impossible to pass a big, his advisors, Larry Summers among them, told him he shouldn't even try for a big stimulus because Congress would never let it happen. We tried for a modest stimulus at the beginning, under $1 trillion, and then never did another stimulus after that. And here we've already begun with a $2 trillion stimulus, and Congress is talking about adding another $1 trillion stimulus on top of it. So it's clear, Mahzarin, just as you said, that it's so recent, 10 years ago, 12 years ago, that the memory is so fresh that at least in certain respects, the government is doing much better. Government that's not under the control of Trump is doing much better than it was doing before. And I'm hopeful that because of that, we, even though the crisis is much worse, I mean, closing the whole economy, you know, the social distancing is a far worse problem than mortgage delinquencies, which caused the 2008 crisis. So the problem is worse, but I'm hopeful that you could imagine a way worse depression than we had in 2008, something akin to the Great Depression. But I'm hopeful that the government has started so soon and so fast, I'm hopeful that actually it won't turn out to be so bad.
I agree. I think with what John just said, it's been heartening to see how quickly the Fed has moved and how quickly the money has been approved to deal with some of this. I think the hard part about the whole situation is that the lost production that we're seeing is really unprecedented. So it's not just a financial crisis. This is a huge problem. And somehow this irrationality in discussion of just, we're going to open the economy and everything's going to go back to normal by summer. It's unfathomable to understand how the real careful look at exactly how we can open all these systems and get them moving again in a way that's not just going to lead to an instant resurgence of the disease, that problem's not being tackled. And that I think is the scariest part about what's going on right now.
Can I just add to that? The $2 trillion act that was passed by Congress is sometimes referred to as a stimulus act, but it's really not, because at this point, businesses are forced to be shut down. Normally, we think that by stimulating demands, we can get the economy back on track. At this point, that's impossible. So the $2 trillion that has already been spent isn't to get the economy back on track. It's just to save people from poverty, basically, to ensure that they can get enough of the necessities to get by, so that when the economy does open, there is something left. Of course, once we have a vaccine, we can imagine businesses at least returning to some semblance of normality. Until then, I think the only feasible path is to ramp up testing to almost a universal level. By that I mean virus testing and antibody testing. If you're free of the virus and you're checked at regular intervals, it should be safe for you to interact with other people. Similarly, if you've been exposed to the virus already and you have antibodies, that should afford you some immunity for some period of time. What businesses are going to have to do, and some of them are already designing such programs, is to use testing of all of their workers as a first step for getting back to some semblance of normality.
So I'd like to call next on Carl Bergstrom, who has his hand up.
I'm actually going to shift my question and just ask Eric for a follow-up, because I'd love to hear his thoughts about what he was just speaking about. So as you go to particularly looking for, allowing people who have antibodies to the virus to work in the workplace, you create these, incentives for people, especially at low risk, to perhaps to deliberately expose themselves, which of course creates risk not only to themselves, but to the population at large. How do you deal with those negative externalities?
Yeah, I don't think that antibody testing should be the key to getting people back to work.
Okay.
It should be the virus test. We do have to have antibody testing to have some idea of what fraction of the population has already been affected. So doing are proposing to do virus testing to get their employees back to work, and they're proposing to do antibody testing to for the benefit of society, so that we have some idea of what the infection rate is.
Okay.
Mirta, your hand is up.
I wanted to ask a question of Eric. I really enjoyed your presentation, everybody else's presentation, but I was just wondering, how can we determine a social benefit of ventilators? And what are your thoughts on the associated uncertainty in estimating how many do we have? How many do we actually need? So obviously one ventilator benefit is equal to some kind of value of life. But if we don't know how many we need, then many will be maybe either extra, unneeded, or the benefit would be much higher if there are not sufficient amount of them. So can you just comment a little bit on uncertainty around estimates of the number we need?
Well, as you well point out, there is enormous uncertainty associated with what the benefit of an additional ventilator might be. So what I was calling the benefit function is really a random variable. My main point was that even if there were no uncertainty about the benefits, there would still be a serious policy problem if you had no idea of what the costs of production were. And mechanism design is not going to solve deciding what the benefit function is. That has to be done by the epidemiologists who can give us some sense of how many people are likely to get ill, and by society as a whole in deciding what value we attach to life. But once we have that benefit function, there is a well-established mechanism in place for determining what production ought to be.
John, you have your hand up?
Yes, thank you. I have a question from Mahzarin. One of the choices, this may be a false choice, but the way Trump is putting it is that we have to weigh the dangers of coronavirus if we open up to the dangers to the economy if we stay retain social distancing. And I was wondering whether you thought that the economic losses were less visible than the coronavirus death, and that therefore we were likely to err on the side of staying closed too long. And maybe we shouldn't be talking about Trump because he probably will err on the other side. But if we talk about, say, Macron, do you think that leaders will tend to err on the side of staying closed too long or staying closed not long enough?
It's a very good question. I know they'll make one of the two errors. My sense is that where public opinion matters, they will stay closed longer than needed. And that may itself be a danger. And we have to be thinking about that. But it's very hard for me. And this is where I think good modeling might be helpful, if we can figure out ways of demonstrating this. When we talk about simple facts, like 32% of the world's population will die of something related to heart disease. But when you ask people, they think that's 11%, you can very easily show what that disparity is. You think it's much lower than it is, but we have those numbers. Here it's going to be incredibly hard to produce a model that is both sophisticated and accurate.
Spiros Skouras, you.
Hi, yeah, Mike, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
So my question is towards the economists who seem to be uniformly pessimistic about what this is going to look like moving forward. How do you square that with the market's view, which seems to be, you know, moderately pessimistic, but not so much? It's up 3% today in the US and generally at the level we were at in 2018.
I might say it would be a good time to take a chance to sell. I find it a complete mystery. I really can't understand the market now. I think it's overly optimistic in terms of how long this is going to last and how difficult it's going to be to reopen economies. And as John was pointing to, I think we're going to deal with some serious credit freezes. And that means that you have a hard time recovering as well and getting the businesses back to normal. So it's hard to see any good economic news out of any of this. And I find it a mystery.
Well, the market rebounded, you know, it fell 30% and now it's back up over 20%. The initial rebound came when the Fed suddenly acted. So I think part of the optimism of the market is that they think the Fed is going to somehow ride to the rescue. But I agree with Matt. It's very lucky we end up where the market ends up where it is now.
I'd like to call on Scott Page.
Hi, Chris. Thanks. I want to expand on the question that John asked. And this is being framed as a trade-off between economic considerations and fatalities due to the virus. But there's other dimensions here. There's social dimensions, there's institutional dimensions that aren't as easily measured, right? How is society holding together? What are people's mental health? Those sorts of concerns. And since this maybe is for Professor Banaji as well, how do we think about creating metrics for those to have those as part of the conversation, because they may be as important as the economic considerations?
Did everyone hear the question?
Who's directed to Mahzarin?
You're muted, Mahzarin.
Mahzarin?
You have to unmute yourself, Mahzarin.
In the meantime, would any of the other panelists like to answer the question?
I think I'm unmuted, but John, do you want to go or do you?
No, you please, you speak.
Well, I was saying to Scott that this is when we realize the deficits of each of us working in separate disciplines, because the clinical psychologist might be able to provide a very good estimate of the mental health cost. Somebody like me may be able to come up with something that we might call a social bias cost. But each of these is one variable in a model that would need to be something that is managed across the social sciences and the life sciences, if not the physical sciences as well. And there is no such effort to my knowledge. And maybe this is the moment to be thinking. And maybe Scott, you are the right person to think about this. Do you see it the way I do, that it's not a fool's errand, but it is absolutely the case that we are not set up to be able to even produce the variables that would go into such a model?
No, I agree. And I think this is a good room to sort of pose that to think about how would we think about taking a metric? I mean, there are these general well-being metrics and flourishing metrics that Stiglitz and other people are proposing, but there's a question of whether those could somehow be brought to the table when we make these evaluations.
There's a question from Lord Alderdice, and I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly.
You are indeed, Chris. Good to join you. I'm speaking from the UK, where I'm a parliamentarian, but also a psychiatrist. One of the dilemmas I think that's being adverted to here is the argument between ensuring we don't have any more fatalities than absolutely necessary, and on the other hand, protecting the economy. But that quickly gets into very polarized political debate, where people who are trying to defend the economy get accused of not caring about people's lives. But taking up the thing that Scott was mentioning earlier on about other costs, one of the things that's at the moment, certainly in our part of the world, being forgotten about are the health costs, not just mental health costs, but the health costs of focusing all your attention on COVID-19. So, for example, lots of people are being cleared out of hospitals to make space for COVID-19 patients, which means that their cancer is not being investigated properly or treated at an early enough stage. And it seems to me that it's going to be necessary and important to bring into the public conversation that COVID-19 is not the only thing you can die from, and that we've got to be quite careful that we don't incur other kinds of costs. Once you get that kind of conversation going on the health front, so that people have to think about balancing fatalities from COVID against fatalities from cancer or heart disease or whatever it is, it may then be possible to move on to the conversation that Scott was adverting to when he was pointing up that on top of health costs and mental health costs, there are social costs and so on and so on.
Does anyone want to respond to that? Right, well, I have a question from Michael Lachman and then a question from Doan Farmer.
I wanted to raise Carl Bergstrom's question again, because I think that using people who are already immune or resistant is one of our main tools to deal with the epidemic in the coming weeks. And I think it's an important question, how to prevent people from either faking it or trying to become immune. It seems also that maybe it's possible to do models where we include the markets together with the immunological models. So is there any way to prevent people from infecting themselves or becoming immune?
Well, since I was talking about this issue before, maybe I'll take a crack at this. I'm in touch with a medical panel which is exploring testing in general, serology, but also virus testing, and it's their opinion that we really do not know enough about immunity to this virus to base any policy, any back to work policy on it yet. If the analogy with other viruses holds up, then there will presumably be some degree of immunity, but we don't know whether that's a matter of months, it's a matter of years. And so their recommendation is not to use antibodies as a determinant of who gets to work and who doesn't get to work at all, at least for quite some time, and instead to concentrate on who currently is infected with the virus. If you're not infected, then you can work.
Doan?
So I wanted to ask basically John and Matt, I wanted to actually follow up on John's question, but sort of ask it back in a different way. My perception is that one of the things that's going on is that the epidemiological effects have been pretty predictable. You know, what the virus quickly established a pattern that if you don't do anything, there's a doubling time of 2 days. And when you start social distancing or taking strong enough measures, you can flatten the curve. And you can pretty much look now at what measures countries are taking, and you can predict where the curve's going to be a month later. Whereas the economics seems a lot less predictable to me. And I think part of what may be going on is that it's between the devil you know and the devil you don't know. And I'm just wondering what you guys think. It seems like we can all agree that the economics looks bad. John, you emphasized the financial side, Matt emphasized the coordination problem of getting restarted, which I think is underappreciated. But I guess, is your perception that there's a clear consensus about just how bad it is? If so, which forecasters do you think are doing good jobs? Or am I correct from the things I'm seeing that the economic forecasts are fairly all over the map? And so there's a lot of uncertainty about the economics, and that's part of why decision makers may be opting for maintaining social distancing longer than needed, or let's say maybe underestimating the economic consequences. So I'm curious Matt, could you?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think you're absolutely correct that this is, it's completely unprecedented what we're seeing in terms of the lost production and this close down of whole economies. And we don't have good forecasts that I've seen. I mean, I've seen a number of people trying to look at what's going to happen in small industries, or you can look at little pockets of the economy, but it's very hard to predict what's going to happen overall. You know, there's certain parts that we know travel is going to be disrupted for long periods of time. Restaurants are going to be disrupted for long periods of time, but how quickly do we get back to, producing automobiles and who will be buying them? These kinds of numbers are just not there. And so I think, as you're correctly pointing out, our tendency is always to focus on the numbers we can see rather than the ones we can't. And if we can see exactly what the disease is doing, we moderate to that, but not necessarily having a good understanding of what all the right ramifications are in terms of the economy. I haven't seen good predictions so far.
Just to follow up on that, I think about my own business. So we buy mortgages from people who have bad FICO scores. I showed you on that graph that it's hard for those people to get a mortgage, so we give them a mortgage, and consumers as well. Turns out that so far, a month in, most of those people are still paying. They're actually still making all their payments. So, but if you were us, would you think that eventually all these people are going to lose their jobs and they won't get them back again? Or would you think, if you don't pay for 3 months and then you go back to paying, that's nothing. The interest rate's so low, it's 2%, 1%, over 3 months, you're not losing anything. On the other hand, if you think they're all going to lose their jobs, or half of them are going to lose their jobs, then our assets are down 50%. It's hard to know what they're worth. I think about the restaurants in New Haven. Yale students went home in March. Yale's thinking, and probably is going to, very possibly cancel the fall semester, delay it to the winter, and delay the winter semester to the summer. So that's gonna half the business of New Haven restaurants is gonna be gone for 9 months. How many restaurants are gonna be left after that in New Haven? It'll be a bloodbath. So it's very hard to predict the future. And if you look at the surveys you were talking about, Don, you probably know this, they are all over the map. Some economists, these are well-respected economists who fill out a particular survey. Some of them think GDP might fall by 50%. Some of them think it's only gonna be down 5%. So it's all over the, never seen such variability.
We're getting near to the end of our allotted time, and I want to take a question from Stephen Guerin, but first I wanted to invite Susan Fitzpatrick, who's been active in the chat. Susan, you've asked a bunch of questions. Do you want to choose one and ask it out loud? Okay, well, I'll go ahead and call on Stephen Guerin then.
Hi, thanks, Chris, and thanks for inviting me in. Just we're working with the governor in what's called the Epidemic Intelligence Unit, which is looking at disease intelligence or disease surveillance. So it's kind of a request or a plea of looking at New Mexico with the SFI perspective. And it's, you know, it's a place where you can apply a lot of the thinking. It might be harder to do it at more the federal or international scale, but, you know, at 2 million people, you know, that fits into a single VM for simulation. Like when Rob Axtell's done very large economic sims, you know, we think we can, you know, we can easily deal with New Mexico to try a lot of these questions. And, you know, on the backside of the curve is we're looking at the importance of testing, isolation, and then contact tracing. You know, different ways of, you see bits about getting apps out there, but novel ways of keeping that information private and not using centralized government databases. So there's some interesting tech sides of what we can do in New Mexico and try out, but also policy and, you know, being informed. And I'll just give you one metaphor that we're under, you know, with a caution that, you know, you don't want to overstretch metaphors, but we've done a lot in wildfire, you know, in the applied complexity space. And SIR and wildfire, both percolation models, both have phase transitions in a very similar way. And just from a public communication, we're using that analogy where S is the fuel or vegetation, I is the contagion or the flame in a fire model, and R being the black or burnt out areas, right? And as you start to make that analogy, there's interesting policy questions as we manage fuels in the West in wildfire. So a prescribed burn is where you're trying to remove that fuel, which is a little bit more intentional, like herd immunity and intentional infection. But there's another one called managed burn, which is you let it strike naturally and let it burn a little bit more, right? So you don't, you know, where do you, you know, a big policy question is when do you let that burn and not do too much social distancing? And ultimately the question I would have for the SFI community, can we talk about being at a critical point in these models? Is there a place where you're expecting to see kind of critical behavior in the epidemic? And, you know, right now we're certainly super critical where you're getting these very large burns because you have no immunity, right? But do we really want to, and are there signatures to know when a community is near the phase transition and we want to accelerate or decelerate social distancing? So those are some of the questions. And again, it's a plea to, you know, and David Krakauer's, he's got his three metaphors of the mountain, the monastery, and the metropolis. So this is an opportunity for SFI to be in the metropolis space a little bit to try out some policy and maybe some working groups around it. So that's it. Yeah.
Any response from our speakers? All right, well,
just a quick response to that. It's Andy Dobson. I mean, one thing, we'll know we got close to that critical point of herd immunity once we start seeing a seasonal signal. We won't see a seasonal signal until we've got the level of immunity up to when it begins to constrain transmission at some times of the year. And so, you know, A, we're not seeing any seasonality or any sign of it yet. So we may have a couple of years to go before we see that, which is worrying at best.
Okay, well, out of respect to the speakers who I'm sure have to get back to very busy schedules, I think we should wrap it up. Do any of the speakers want to add anything in conclusion? There is one hand up from Chris. Is it something that you think is quick? Chris@dusacco.com.
Yeah, this could be very quick. I just am curious when I think of what nobody seems to have addressed is this other huge unknowable from an economic point of view, which is what does near zero interest rates mean if somebody borrows a great deal more money at 0.5% or 1% or 1.5% versus 8%, you could have, you know, we don't have any way to model this sort of zero interest rate world and how that could affect the ability for people to be carried through this by borrowing without increasing future risk. I think it's an interesting question to sort of carry forward.
Interest rates have been very low for quite a long time now, so we have some experience with that.
Yeah, you know, but I guess I'd be more that if we aren't looking at interest rates relative to cash flow when we're simply looking at collateral values, for example. And so the ability for, you know, a restaurant to be out of business for some long period of time, incur a great deal of debt at a very, very low interest rate, and yet be able to carry that debt is something that I think the models have a hard time looking at, because you can get almost sort of a nonsensical amount of leverage at a super low interest rate that can give you a lot of time to work through that problem.
It helps that the interest rate is low, but the trouble is if there's still the amount of debt. This is like a Greek problem. If what you owe is more than the whole business is worth, you're going to be in trouble, even if your interest payments are low. They used to say that Greece will face no problems because its interest is low, even though its debt is two times its GDP. But, you know, in a business, eventually the day comes when you have to pay the whole debt back. And that could be a big, so even at zero interest, you could be in trouble.
Thank you.
Okay, any final thoughts from the speakers? Well, I really appreciate you all participating, and there may be another one of these in about 2 weeks as we explore, with the help of lots of different disciplines, different aspects of the pandemic and how to get through it and what to do next. Thank you very much.